design and build a solar house appropriate to Saskatchewan. And the fellow that was heading us up was an engineering physicist and had no experience in buildings at all. And so he asked a number of people to sit on this committee, and he had an architect from CMHC. He had several builders from the House Builders Association. He had another architect that we hired to design the house. And he asked me to sit on the committee because I was involved in their lead engineer Titans and so on. And so we got together. Before we did this, we were involved in a little back of the envelope calculation. And we knew the situation in Saskatchewan, if we were going to use solar hot water to heat the house, we essentially needed an Olympic swimming pool to store the water. And in fact, at the same time, a group here in Toronto built the Provident House, somewhere up close to where we're going today. And they built this Provident House that was teepee, and the one wall sloped at an optimum angle for two stories down to the ground, and they put solar collectors on this and used the whole basement for water storage. And they called it the Provident House, and I think they misnamed it. It should have been called the Prove It Don't Work House. Because of course you have this tank of
warm water.
Hot water. And it's going to evaporate, and so the humidity in the house is just going to be out of the world. And they never heard of building air tightness in the house.
So it just went up through the house and rotted the outside on it.
Anyway, I don't know whatever became of it, but I came and visited one day and I just shook my head. It proved that it doesn't work.
No.
So anyway, we were involved and asked to build this solar house appropriate for Saskatchewan. And we did these calculations, and that didn't work. So we were then going to have to reduce the heat loss very significantly in terms of the house. And somebody suggested, well, why don't we use R20 in the walls? Because that was three times what we were currently putting in at that time. And I said, well, I know for a fact that isn't going to do it, fellas, because I've had several people who have built houses with R20 in the walls, and they weren't getting the bang for their buck that they wanted. And I attribute this primarily to air leakage problem. And so when I volunteered on the Saskatchewan Conservation House to actually install a vapor barrier, and so I took a technician from the National Research Council. The
two of us. Northwest on Ontario Tent or Boston Mills Road.
Then we went to Regina, and the two of us installed the 6 mil polyethylene vapor barrier, being very careful of the details of where it penetrates ceiling joists and walls meet at the walls and so on. And we did, I think, a remarkable job, because we had a blower door at that time, and we did the estimate of the house, and it was half an air change per hour, 50 pascals.
That's great.
So anyway, after we did this, I perceived that the situation was not that we could build new houses like this and repeat that and do equivalent. But what about the other 4, 5, 15 million houses that we currently have available? Like that one.
Yeah.
And so one of the things we did there was to we borrowed a house from CMHC that they had vacant, and we proceeded to try and do the same thing on the house as we had done with the Saskatchewan Conservation House.
On an existing house?
On an existing house. And this has now become known as the chainsaw retrofit. Okay. We actually cut the leaves and the overhangs off some snake. We nailed strips of plywood over the raw edges where we cut off the roof and so on. And then we wrapped the house, roof included, right down and sealed it to the concrete foundation with 6 mil poly. And we got it down to below a half an air change per hour, 50 pounds.
And the idea then is to put your insulation outside
and
of that?
Well, we started on the roof. What we did was we put 2x8 at the peak, a 2x8 at the edge, and then 1.5 feet between. Put new rafters on there, and then we filled the 12 inches of space with insulation, R40 plus insulation, and then we hung a new outside wall that gave us 12 inches of insulation, and carried this down to a foot above ground, and then went with just a 4-inch wall from there to, from a foot above to a foot below ground. I went inside and put a foot of insulation on the inside of the foundation, and then 3 inches of styrofoam on the basement floor, and plywood on top of that. And we achieved essentially the same thing with an existing house. So as a result of this, I then did quite a little bit of work on terms of how can we do this, how can we build houses better and achieve this every time when we build them. And the one thing that I like here is the what we call the prairie double wall. Now, the prairie double wall is uses the outside walls of every house is used for the last basically 100 years across the country, which is a 2x4 wall, and while we're building it, the wall is built on the subfloor. And while we do this, while it's laying on the subfloor, we square it, get it ready to put sheathing on it, and then we put the vapor barrier on the top side of the wall, and then put sheathing on top of that. And I would like somebody to make a sheathing that was only $4 a square for a 4x8 sheet instead of the 12, 13, 14. But anyway, put sheathing on it. And we make sure the poly sticks out far enough so that it comes to the inside of the 2x4 so we can join it to the vapor barrier on the ceiling or the vapor barrier going across the floor area or whatever. We use this floor while it's still lying on the floor as a jig to build the outside wall, which is now a light frame. Doesn't have to need all the structural components. And we lift it up for the space we want between the two walls, normally 5.5 inches or 8.25 inches. And then we nailed strips of plywood on the top and the bottom to fasten the two walls together. And we made the windows some door openings so we can line the windows and doors with sheathing as well.
Mm-hmm.
And then we insulate between the two walls and insulate the outer wall, and then we stand the wall up. And now the wall sits out past the floor header. And so we nail the inner bottom plate to the floor joist, and we need support out there, but no ways we can do that. But now we have a wall that has something in the order of R40 on the outside of a vapor barrier, and the vapor barrier is on the outside of the inside wall, so the electrical wiring and so on doesn't have to be wrapped and sealed. Doesn't have to have poly pans and all of this sort of stuff.
Sealed boxes, all that stuff is gone.
It's gone, and it makes installing the electrical considerably cheaper. But we can still put insulation on there and drywall on the inside. And now we have a wall that's R50 or R60 or R70, whatever. And the other advantage we find there is that we place this vapor that is five of the top plates and the bottom plates, so the wall is twice as high as the conventional wall by that amount, by normally about 3/4 of an inch. So this means if the we can put the floor trusses, the ceiling trusses on, and we can go inside and put a vapor barrier and drywall on the ceiling as big pieces instead of doing it little piece here and little piece there.
Oh, because you've not top plates the interior walls.
Well, the partitions are 3/4 of an inch shorter than the outside walls. And in fact, I was watching one contractor doing this in Saskatoon, and he was doing a 1,400 square foot house. No partitions inside. They had the walls up and the trusses on and the roof sheathing on and shingled. And these two fellows came in there, and in 2 hours, 2.5 hours, they had the vapor barrier on the whole 1,400 foot ceiling. They had the drywall on the thing, and when they got finished, they'd pick up all the scrap drywall in one hand, take it out, and put it in the average. Instead of the normal situation where they get all these little things, you have a half-ton truck full of drywall
scrap bits.
So anyway,
it seemed like you were going to talk about heat exchanger.
Well, Dick Van E, when we built the Saskatchewan Conservation House, we realized we were going to need an air heat exchanger. So Dick Van E was working at the university as an engineering technician in the laboratory, something, engineering laboratories, undertook to build the first air heat exchanger with his. And what he used was 6 mil poly and 1/2 inch. Plywood. We cut the plywood into strips, and then we wove the poly back and forth. And he entered the exhaust air at the top. The exhaust air went at the top, went down through it, and came out of the bottom. The fresh air coming in came in the bottom, went up, counterflow up 8 feet or this and came to the inside. And he was using buoyancy effects of the air, the warm air being more buoyant than the cold.
Mm-hmm.
And it worked very effectively. But he was started then building air-to-air heat exchangers for pig barns. And it didn't need to be nearly as efficient, and it was so much easier to use this. It looks like corrugated cardboard that's made out of plastic, and you cut these pieces, and it's a counter cross-flow heat exchanger. And unfortunately, with cross-flow heat exchanger, you about 70% efficiency. And I wish they would rebuild these things and make them much more efficient, which they could do.
Yeah, some of them are starting to hit 80s now. They're hitting 75. 75 is standard. SRE, yeah. Sensible.